The first one is our first and only keynote speaker for this session is Professor Serdar Öztürk from Turkey. He will be speaking about Sina philosophy and the new way of doing philosophy. And just to get his info and bio, he has a PhD, of course. He's a professor at the Department of Radio, Television, and Cinema at the Faculty of Communication in Ankara, HPV University. He's a founder and publisher and editor of the journal Cine Philosophy in Turkey. And he will be talking to us about his subject, which is Cine Philosophy, a new way of doing philosophy. As I said earlier, he has 40 minutes, and Professor Öztürk, the virtual floor is yours. You may proceed.
Thank you. First of all, let me show a PowerPoint screen. I hope you can see it.
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
It's clear.
Okay. First of all, I would like to thank to the Philosophical Society of Macedonia and Philosophical Film Festival Organization team for inviting me to make a speech in this distinguished philosophy and film conference. I would like to start with a simple but a very distinguished question. How can we construct the relationship between cinema and philosophy? What is the best way of making a distinction between philosophy and cinema? Or do we think that, in fact, there is indeed a philosophy, but there are different ways of doing philosophy? If so, can we think that film can do philosophy in its own way, technique, and through its own medium? I would like to discuss these questions in my presentation. First, I want to start with the meaning of cinema and philosophy in order to pass my argument. What is cinema? Of course, there are many definitions. It is a big question, but to put it simply, in my belief, cinema can be thought of as a composition. What kind of composition? As Deleuze said, movement images and time images produced by camera movement, camera angles, shots, frames, angles, color, sound, lighting, screenplay, and acting. Deleuze classified images in cinema as basically, as you know, two main images, movement images and time images. For me, we can use a short description to classify these images, cine images. Cinema is made with cine images. And the second question, what is philosophy? Of course, there are many definitions of philosophy. Kant characterized philosophy as the attempt to answer these basic questions. What can I do? What should I do? What can I hope for? And Deleuze and Guattari claims for philosophy creating concepts. Philosophy does not question everything according to them. Wherever it finds a problem, philosophy reflects on it. Alain Badiou as well thinks that philosophy considers paradoxes. If there isn't a relationship between some things, philosophy reflects on this. And finally, Henri Bergson claimed doing philosophy means an intervention in common or usual thinking. In daily life, we think that we think, but in fact, it is a common sense. We should get away from ordinary thinking in order to engage in philosophical thinking. As you see, these philosophers put on emphasis on the problem. In philosophical thinking, there must be a problem. So here is a problem. On the one hand, cinema is made with cine images. On the other hand, philosophy is done by concepts. What kind of relation can we see between them? Is it possible to bring cine images and concepts, cinema and philosophy side by side? Plato claimed, you know, claimed that images mislead us. Images are outside of the real world. For him, for Plato, concepts or ideas, you know, belong to the true world, fundamental world, the world of ideas. Plato himself believed that since art imitates physical things, which in turn imitate the forms, art is always a copy of a copy. And art always leads us, you know, even further from the truth and toward illusion. According to Plato, you know, work of art are at best entertainment and at worst a dangerous delusion. Philosophy, for him, enlightens us and tries to help us to get away from the delusion of images. A great many philosophers agree with Plato about the image issue. According to them, images and concepts or truth are against each other. As Badiou claims, if there is a relationship between philosophy and cinema, this might be a hate relationship. Hate. Philosophy throughout its history has hated images and to some extent still keeps this position. From this explanations, we can easily understand the reason why many philosophers generally reject cinema in favor of thinking and concepts. They believe that cinematic images can distract attention from the full intellectual and logical universe. Cinematic images belong to, you know, entertainment or the art world. They may objectify some philosophical concepts at best. The second problem I would like to put forward is the opposition between art and the mass appeals of cinema. Assessing this paradox, Badiou calls cinema a mass art, as you know. What is mass art? Films are loved by millions of people all around the world at the moment they were made. At this point, the key expression here, at the moment. Of course, millions of people can go to ancient historical places, but in the case of movies, sometimes you can forward some things. while we are focusing, we are forgetting everything. Okay, now probably I am here. The second problem I would like to put forward is the opposition, art and mass, mass appeals. Films are loved by millions of people. And the key expression at the moment, millions of people can go to historical places. Yes, but they are not at the time. Charlie Chaplin's movies were watched by people all around the world at the time his films were made. Today, you know, Christopher Nolan's Interstellar can be watched all around the world in every corner, even on cell phones by millions. In the movie, we witness the genetic elements which are profound and essential for all human beings. All people actually depend on the fate of the world, our home. Our home, the world, is much important than our daily issues, our political or economic clashes with each other. This film presents the fundamental element for us. The mass dimension of movies can reflect and construct a generic humanity, as Alain Badiou said. Cinema not only has mass dimension, it is also an art. This double regime of cinema, meaning mass and art, you know, is a paradoxical relationship. Mass is both an industrial and also political category. The culture industry produces products and distributes them to people all around the world. But mass at the same time implies a political activism. Today, people can get together both in physical and virtual spaces in order to resist political pressures. To the contrary, art basically belongs to aristocratic category. Why? Because art includes creating aesthetic and artful products, and not everyone can tackle this. Besides, understanding the meaning of art requires education to a certain extent. In brief, you know, cinema belongs to the political and industrial category on the one hand, and aristocratic category on the other hand. This is a paradoxical relationship. What is the meaning of this paradoxical relationship? Philosophy focuses on paradoxes, as I have said before. Wherever philosophy finds a problem, a paradox, there emerges thinking. It means, now that there is a paradoxical relationship between cinema and philosophy, or mass and art, philosophy thinks about it. Plato dealt with images because in his view, images had no relations with ideas. Wherever we find no relationship case, it means we may encounter with philosophical situation. We may perceive why images and rational thinking, or cinema and philosophy, or mass and artistic concepts convey the philosophical situation. Philosophy considers relationships which have no relations or relations foreign to each other. Images and concepts are foreign to each other. Mass and art are foreign to each other. Therefore, philosophy reflects on cinema. Between them, it has a distance and interval. This is one of the general views on the relationship between cinema and philosophy. You can put cinema on the one hand and place philosophy on the other side, divide them, and claim that there is no relationship between them. But is this really so? I want to discuss this. In my speech, I want to focus on the idea based on the features of media, because I come from media studies and communication studies. That is why I focused on the media, the features of media. But before I do, in order to pass my argument, I want to clarify different approaches to the relationship between cinema and philosophy, because many people who are ordinary people can watch us as well. Not only philosophers, but also people, ordinary people can watch the YouTube channel maybe. We should collect some ideas. So why philosophers are interested in cinema? The second thing. A philosopher may be interested in cinema for a few reasons. The first one is because of the entertaining aspect of cinema. You know, as Bela Balázs claimed, cinema, first of all, has the fundamental capacity of entertaining people. It is a natural feeling for any person to want to be entertained. Even Wittgenstein spent time watching movies. Philosophers need to get rid of the pressures of the rational thinking and logic. The second reason why a philosopher might deal with cinema, I think, comes from cine images. What is their ontological status? Are they a psychological entity or beyond our subjective viewpoint? You know, we know that Bergson and Deleuze discussed the concept of images. There emerge some questions here. What is movement? What is time? Are images real movement or artificial movements? Certain philosophers discuss this issues. In the Republic, you know, Plato as well, with the famous cave allegory, took up the issue of images. We may call this approach the philosophy of film, an approach about the ontic status of cine images. A third reason why a philosopher might care about cinema is because I think she or he wonders about the film experience. This is the key point. Watching a movie is a different experience than reading a book or listening to a musical performance. With movies, we leave the experience visually. We are inside the images, cine images, while watching. But reading a book requires us to imagine the written medium rather than living the experience as they are. We may call this approach philosophy and cinematic experience. Another reason for a philosopher to deal with cinema is because of the illustrative aspect of movies. What does it mean? In the philosopher's mind, there are some concepts like death, freedom, being, life, reality, happiness, existence, etc. And films illustrate these kinds of concepts. Today, philosophy teachers can benefit from movies or movie scenes in order to teach some philosophical themes to students. A common example is the movie Matrix. You know, what is reality? What is appearance? Reality has attracted many philosophers in the history of philosophy. In the Matrix, in the digital world, humans lived like the slaves of Plato's cave, while machines set up a phenomenal world for humans. This approach can be called film about philosophy, a term for movies that illustrate philosophical ideas. In fact, some movies bring up some philosophical issues in a central and serious way. If a director focuses on philosopher's life or his basic concepts, a film can be about philosophy. Films about the philosopher's life or their views can attract many philosophers. These are philosophical movies, like The Matrix Trilogy by Wachowski Brothers, A Clockwork Orange by Stanley Kubrick, and Wittgenstein by Derek Jarman. Yeah, although there are some differences between these approaches, they share a similar idea. There is a reference point called philosophy. It means ratio, you know, logic and concepts come first, and cinema is just instrument for philosophy. Cinema is used to illustrate philosophical themes. Cinema, according to these views, is like a shadow, a phenomenal world of philosophy. Now, I would like to turn my attention to a different approach to cinema. Film as philosophy, or movie-made philosophy, or as I put it, cine philosophy. What is it? Films can do philosophy with their optic and sonic images or cine images with their own style. I mean, the basic medium of film is not a written or verbal medium. It is a visual medium or cine image. Films can do philosophy with cine images rather than through a written or verbal medium. I call it cine philosophy. Daniel Frampton defines this approach filmosophy. And Thomas Wartenberg and Tal Shamir calls it cinematic philosophy. Whatever we name it, the important thing is that films can do a different philosophy. This is another kind of philosophy. It is a kind of, you know, a movie-made philosophy. This philosophy does not reject written or oral philosophy. It is just a different philosophy. Now, I would like to discuss its basic features. In philosophical discussions, many philosophers and social scientists generally neglect the medium. A medium is a kind of platform or platform on which you can load and transfer your ideas. For example, you know, in order to make my speech and convey my ideas to you, I use an oral platform and a digital platform. Before I made my speech, my ideas were on a paper. The written medium in this example is another medium. Cinema is a different medium, a cinematic medium done with cine images. We should delineate the details of the features of mediums and the relationships between medium and philosophy. Philosophy began with Socratic dialogues in the ancient Agora in ancient Greece. And Socrates particularly was against the written medium. He believed the written word could not answer all questions. It is a rigid form of media. For him, the written text could not answer all questions. And also the text freezes the poetic and dialogical talk. The written medium, Socrates argued, is impossible to change. And also the written medium repeats itself when it is read. It is impossible to change the written text. Besides, you know, the text cannot defend itself. Socrates comes to the conclusion that writing has a lower status than dialogue. Dialogue is the best medium for achieving truth. And during the Socratic era, philosophy was done by oral dialogues. And no one claimed whether or not it was a philosophical discussion. As you see, during the Socratic era, the new medium, the written word, was an invasion. Invention that was used to the philosophy. It was new, and ancient philosophers had been living under an oral tradition. They connected philosophy with oral speech, not the written word. But over time, when they internalized the written word, forms of doing philosophy changed. The practice of writing and reading came first. Socrates had been wrong by not perceiving the potential of the new technology, meaning writing, during his time. Today, I think in our contemporary world, some philosophers are making the same kind of mistake by not seeing the new medium, cine images. Cine images have the potential of the cinematic platform to engage with philosophy. But I want to clarify is that there is no pure platform for creating philosophy. Philosophy was not born with writing. It means philosophy is not objectively and purely connected to writing. Doing philosophy with cine images is a new possibility for engaging with philosophical thinking. There can be different ways of doing philosophy. As you see written, written philosophy, oral philosophy, and cine philosophy. There is no hierarchy among them. This is important point. There is no hierarchy. We can just say that every medium has its own style and is different from the other. If so, I would like to move to another issue, the relationship between film and philosophy. In the beginning of my speech, I mentioned the paradoxical relationship between philosophy and cinema, and also I emphasized that it is wrong to make a distinction between philosophy and cinema. I want to express that cinema is just another way of doing philosophy. Medium is a key term to understand this point. In fact, the new paradox emerged from my discussion about the medium. Accepting that cinema is another way of doing philosophy doesn't mean that using the conjunction and between and between cinema and philosophy is a mistake. I mean, if we use the expression cinema and philosophy, it means that there is a gap, a distance between cinema and philosophy. In fact, according to my argument, there are different ways of doing philosophy, and cinema cannot be separated from philosophy. At this point, the use of and in film and philosophy or cinema and philosophy is unnecessary. Consciously or unconsciously, we are driven by the thought that cinema is not a natural platform for doing philosophy. Many philosophers think that directors produce movies and philosophers reflect on films. Philosophers believe that films just illustrate written philosophical ideas. But if we adopt the cine philosophy approach, we should understand that it is a mistake to make a separation between cinema and philosophy. We can use cine philosophy rather than using the film and philosophy dichotomy. After that, we can divide philosophy into three categories: oral philosophy, written philosophy, and cine philosophy. If we make a comparison with Spinoza's thinking, I think we can reach a better understanding of my argument. Spinoza made a distinction between substance and attributes. There is one substance, and attributes are just manifestations of the substance. Attributes are expressions, of the substance. In my discussion, the substance is philosophy or philosophical thinking, and attributes are different media like oral, written, and cine image. Different mediums are extensions of the substance, meaning philosophy. Each medium provides a different and authentic access to philosophy. Doing philosophy with a written philosophy, written word, meaning written philosophy, is not superior to philosophy done with cine images, meaning cine philosophy. If we accept this idea, naturally there could be a room for the possibility that films can create a philosophy by themselves. Interestingly, many philosophers don't want to discuss the relationship between oral philosophy and written philosophy. In ancient Greece, as I have mentioned before, Socrates was doing oral philosophy, and Plato, what did Plato do? Plato wrote these dialogues after Socrates. No philosopher has claimed this argument up to this time. I am showing this argument. Written philosophy is an illustration of oral philosophy. The main philosophy is oral philosophy done by Socrates. And I just illustrated Socrates' ideas. I am typewriter representing Socrates' dialogues via the written text. Yes, it is a ridiculous idea to claim that Plato was a typewriter for Socrates' arguments. Every philosopher accepts that Plato stands on his own as a philosophical creator. The relationship between philosophy and cinema can be raised on this basis. It has a variety of mediums. Each of them offers different perspectives and also they are connected with each other. One platform like cinema cannot replace another platform like writing. Each medium or platform has a crucial linkage with each other. Rather than talking about film and philosophy, I believe we can suggest cine philosophy, written philosophy, and oral philosophy. Film and philosophy are not separate fields. We can do written philosophy via written medium. We can do oral philosophy via oral speech, or we can do cine philosophy via cine images. Each medium or platform has limitations and possibilities. Each platform has the potential for engaging with philosophy. Each medium leads to the creation of different types of philosophical works. It is a contribution to philosophy. Different types of medium presents a variety of possibilities. For example, we can create a rational discussion and use concepts with a written philosophy more easily than cine philosophy. Why? Because cine images are basically affective. They touch our bodies. We can be affected emotionally and sensually. And also emotion and affection are not totally outside of the rational discussion, rational dimension. David Hume, you know, Spinoza, Nietzsche, Deleuze, and today many neuroscientists emphasize this point. Cine operations like shots, frames, camera angles, camera movement, montage, and lighting reach the audience through heart and senses, rather than through the rational mind. Film makes us see the world and experience it. Philosopher directors, as Orson Welles, Ingmar Bergman, Akira Kurosawa, you know, Andrei Tarkovsky, Robert Bresson, Alfred Hitchcock, Stanley Kubrick, Jean-Luc Godard, Louis Buñuel, know how to create an idea as an experience. In the written text, ideas are abstractions of the mind, but in cine images, are ideas are sensations as perceptions of the body. It means cinema can merge an idea with a sensual experience. If we put together our brain and our physical body via different types of philosophical platforms, I believe philosophy can come down from the academic ivory tower to the bazaar, to the agora. I call cinema philosophy of the bazaar as well as art of the bazaar. Everyone who has the abilities to see and hear can reach the philosophy of movies. Therefore, cinema is a democratic platform for doing philosophy. One of the biggest differences between written philosophy and cine philosophy is based upon the separation between reflection or imagination and experience. To put it simply, written philosophy reflects or imagines the problems or paradox, whereas cine philosophy makes us live the experience as it is. A film has the potential to make us see or experience the thinking in action. But the written text requires us to imagine or reflect upon the ideas. A film creates this experience with its instruments, like camera movement, camera angles, montage. But the written text is static and stands on the paper by itself. By reading, we imagine the meaning rather than experiencing it. Films show the idea as an event in motion. And text makes us imagine the idea. Experience is a key term here. As Krakauer claimed, in modern life, things are lost. They become invisible. Our pragmatic view, ideological apparatus, science, and technology frames the reality. Heidegger made a distinction between calculative thinking and meditative thinking. Calculative thinking is in connection with the dominance of science and technology in our life. Being slips away from our gaze. How can human faces, animals, plants, and inorganic world be visible? As Bela Balazs stated, films let people see human faces, which had been lost since the invention of the printing press. With letters, we just read about the human faces in the books and imagined them. We could not experience the intensity of faces with all the lines on them. But films made human face visible Again, Krakauer argued films not only showed human faces, but also other things, including inorganic life. Today's streets, faces, homes, railway stations lie before eyes, but in fact, they are invisible to us. Our pragmatic life, customs, habits, scientific and technological gaze make them invisible. So films revealed the abstract life surrounding us. Written philosophy generally works with abstractions and generalizations. This abstract thinking is outside of the agora, where philosophy was born. Films can concrete abstract thinking. And Whitehead, you know, Whitehead said, quote, when you understand all about the atmosphere, when you understand all about the sun and all about the atmosphere, and all about the rotation of the earth, you may still miss the radiance of the sunset. How can we experience the sunset as it is without abstraction? Whitehead claimed art and aesthetic education can give this experience. Krakauer argues cinema can help us to touch the reality, not only fingerprints, but also, you know, shake hands with it. For the first time, cine images made us possible to experience the material life from bottom to top. Other arts and philosophy, written philosophy, proceed from top to bottom. But cinema starts with raw material and helps us to appreciate our given material environment. As Krakauer said, films virtually make the world our home. To make the world our home, to experience our home as it is. This is one of the basic characteristics of cine philosophy. To end my speech, I would like to sum up my arguments. Philosophy started mainly as an oral tradition in the Greek marketplace, the agora. Then, with the written word, philosophy abandoned its origins and transferred itself to the academic ivory tower. Philosophy became synonymous with writing and later printing, and then they influenced philosophy. Philosophical written and printed texts were taught to be philosophy. What is the price of this? We have paid a very heavy price. Philosophy was alienated from common language, common people, everyday life. In the beginning, philosophy was with young people, everyday people at the bazaar. But now philosophy is alienated from its origins. It became aristocratic thinking. I believe cine philosophy is a great opportunity to make philosophy accessible once again. Cine philosophy can make a great contribution to creating new concepts and thoughts in philosophical thinking. Cine philosophy is a new way of doing philosophy. That is it. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Öztürk. Where do I begin? Probably nowhere, because if I begin, I will take somebody else's time. Very inspiring. You covered many issues, many important things. You gave us a new, a controversial idea between cinema and philosophy, which is quite new to me. I don't know about someone else, but I really hope that we can discuss these issues that you touched upon in the discussion. So I'm urging everyone to participate in the discussion once this session is over. And to write down the questions on our Facebook page or in the Zoom meeting for the ones that are not actively engaged in this conference. Now,
the question is from Kanika Valia. First of all, a words of appreciation for the participants. So, dear all, thank you so much for today's wonderful sessions. I have a question, and this is to Professor Sedar Ozturk from second session. The question relates to the topic of classification of philosophical cinema. What are the classification of philosophical cinema? And do you think that there is any categories in philosophical cinema? And if yes, where does the philosophical films lies in those categories? How they are, say, distributed throughout those categories? Thank you very much to Kanika Valia. And please, Professor Ozturk, would you like to answer to it?
Okay, thank you. I think it is very difficult question in many ways, because in my argument, you know, I classify three types of philosophies: writing philosophy, oral philosophy, and cine philosophy. Mm-hmm. And when we look at the feature of medium, we can have a look at the basic structure of some things. I mean, we are making some oral speech in daily life, and there are different types of level of dialogues, ordinary dialogue, chatting, or you know, making irony, something like this. In order to survive in our daily life, we are just producing some speeches. But on the other hand, we are making speech here in a different level. It is a very highly intellectual level. And people have to understand, have to imagine, have to reflect on what we have said. Imagination and reflection comes at this point. So there are different types of books as well. You know, bestseller books, and also philosophical books, sociological books, science books. There are different types of books. So now that there are different types of books, and also there are different types of speeches, dialogues, oral speeches, we can conclude that there are different types of movies as well. It is natural for different types of movies. I think Deleuze is right in many ways. And he made a separation between movement images and time images. After the First World War, after the Second World War, the meaning of cinema has changed, because cinema went to thought. So thought, I think, is the basic criteria in many way. Instead of using philosophical movies, I prefer to use thought movies. Thought movies, you know, because according to Deleuze's argument, we perceive some things and according to our perception, we act. This is the motor sensory sicama, you know, habitual recognition in the meaning of Bergson, habitual, automatic recognition. So when you pass into the thought level, habitual recognition can change into, you know, attentive recognition, which means we don't need to act in accordance with the perception. There is a interval. There is an interval between them, how can we fill up this interval? By memory, by dreams, by seeing the objects. So what is important and the basic starting point, I believe that, to see the being, And when we see the being in itself, actually thinking starts. It means that some directors tries to create some ideas in a way that you can see some things in a total way, in being in itself. You know, Roberto Rossellini created a movie, Stromboli, you know, and also Europe 51. The bourgeois woman was a different person before her son died, but her son, after her son died, he saw the factory in a different way. Her point of view has changed. And she started to think. And cinema shows us the thinking of the woman. So it is a philosophical movie. It is a philosophical movie. Why? Because we are not extending the perceptual thing into the action, but we are filling the gap with seeing some things as they are. Maybe I can answer this question like this. So finally, maybe my classification about the movies is like this. On the one hand, commercial movies, you know, mass movies, but maybe we can classify these movies under three titles. Mass movies, when we look at the Netflix environment platform, we can see these kind of movies. But this is not spirit of cinema. This is not spirit of cinema. And the second kind of movie, thought movies, I think, which I have mentioned before. And the third kind of movie, I think, hybrid. It is a kind of combination of movies. On the one hand, you can get some cinematical composition from the mass movies. On the other hand, thought movies. It is like mixing the mass movies and thought movies, I think. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this conceptual qualification. The classification questions are always difficult. We all know that. So please